Greetings. Thank you for your interesting comment, brother. I try to never critique English grammar and syntax, capitalization and punctuation. So to avoid that, I'm going to clean up this posted comment, hoping I accurately interpret it. Believing that a human is a god is why Jesus was sent to the cross. Also because of the snake that betrayed him. None of Jesus' disciples said he is God, only in the book of John, which was written 200 years after Jesus. Let's look at this Muslim rhetoric, line by line, for the many misunderstandings it represents. Believing that a human is a god is why Jesus was sent to the cross. As with any error, or worse, an intentional lie, and I'm not saying this is a lie, a little poison is mixed in with a larger dose of truth. Clarified, this assertion is that Jesus was sent to the cross because of a belief that a human was a god. But this does not say who believed this. Was it Jesus? His followers? The Romans? Or the Jewish leaders? Some or all of the above? As a basic assertion, brother, this simply fails to demonstrate any coherent understanding of the events or situation. Perhaps the first misunderstanding we must address is, why was Christ killed? While saying, because the prophet said so, may be factually correct, it is not an intellectually satisfying answer. So maybe we begin by taking another step backwards. Where do the prophets reveal that Messiah would die? If we can establish the prophets foretold Messiah would die, maybe they say why as well. Daniel 9:26, and after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood, and till the end of the war desolations are determined. We know Jesus was the Messiah. Even Muslims claim Jesus was the Messiah. Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. Prophet Daniel said the Messiah would be killed. But Texas, how do you know cut off means killed and not just excommunicated? Prophet Isaiah tells us, Isaiah 53:8, by oppression and judgment he was taken away, and who can recount his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. Cut off from the land of the living means his death, not simply a change in country or synagogue. Prophet Isaiah even says why the Messiah would die. He was stricken for the transgression of my people. When we examine the message of these two prophets, it is very clear. In Daniel, Messiah shall be cut off. In Isaiah, for he was cut off from the land of the living. Messiah will die, but not for himself. He was stricken for the transgression of my people. Messiah dies for others. The prophets reveal why Messiah had to die. It is not because belief that a human was a god. It is because Messiah had to die for others. That's really important to understand. It does not hinge on some people recognizing Jesus fulfilled prophecies of the prophet or of the Lord foretold by Prophet Malachi. Jesus, Yeshua, the Messiah, had to die because that was God's plan. The plan that Jehovah God sent the prophets to reveal. What about the manner of death? Crucifixion. Was that foretold by the prophets? Absolutely. It is interwoven as imagery in multiple ways, by multiple prophets. In Genesis, we see Isaac prepared for offering as a burnt offering by Abraham. Genesis 22:8, and Abraham said, "My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering." So they went both of them together. Research what burnt means, and you will find the burnt offering is called the ascent offering, because the sacrifice, the smoke, rises up to God. Jesus said he would be lifted up, and if I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all peoples to myself. This he said, signifying by what death he would die. And as I'm doing this, I'm also recalling in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said to Mary, "Do not touch me, I have not yet ascended to my Father." So Jesus, Prophet Jesus, foretold he would be crucified. And we know from Prophets Daniel and Isaiah, he was killed for the forgiveness of the sins of his people. Also, we know from the prophets that there is no forgiveness without the shedding of blood. Leviticus 17:11. This is Moses. "For the life of a creature is in the blood, and I have given it to you to make an atonement for your souls upon the altar, since it is the life blood that makes atonement." Hebrews 9:22. "Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins." Is blood shed during crucifixion? Absolutely. When Jesus was whipped, when Jesus was crowned with thorns, when his hands and feet were pierced, and when his side was pierced. Do the prophets foretell any of the details of Jesus' death and suffering? Isaiah 53:5, "But he was wounded for our transgressions." That goes back to Messiah would die for the sins of his people. "He was bruised for our iniquities." That's when he was beaten. "The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." The stripes are from when he was whipped. Psalm 22:16, "For dogs have surrounded me. The congregation of the wicked has enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet." That describes crucifixion. It was not a common practice before the Romans. Zechariah 12:10, "And I will pour on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem." Prophet Zechariah clearly reveals who he's talking about. The inhabitants of Jerusalem. "And I will pour on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. Then they will look on me whom they pierced. Yes, they will mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, and grieve for him as one grieves for a firstborn." Look what they did. The inhabitants of Jerusalem pierced Jehovah God. This is Jehovah God speaking through Prophet Zechariah. "I will." Let that sink in. "And I will pour me whom they pierced." God is talking. God was pierced. Jesus was not sacrificed as an afterthought or as a reaction, an unplanned, unforeseen event. It was not an error or an accident triggered by a blasphemous misunderstanding. Revelation 13:8, "And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him." This actually speaks of the Antichrist being worshipped by all that dwell on the earth. It further clarifies, limiting all to specifically the damned. All whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Jesus knew the scriptures foretold of his suffering and death. Matthew 26:24, the Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. It would be better for him, the man who betrays him, if he had not been born. Jesus knew he would be betrayed. Jesus was not overpowered. He could have stopped it, but knew the plan. Matthew 26:52. But Jesus said to him, "Put your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels?" Jesus could have called for enough angels to slaughter all of humanity. Jesus continues speaking, though, and we need to notice the context. How then could the scriptures be fulfilled that it must happen thus, or it must happen this way? It must happen according to the scriptures. If Jesus stopped the coming events, the scourging, torture, and crucifixion, death, and resurrection, scripture would not have been fulfilled. Numbers 23:19. God is not a man that he should lie, or a son of man that he should change his mind. Does he speak and not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? No, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob fulfills his word, his message, his promises. Jesus also recited to them scripture that showed Messiah would be rejected. Matthew 21:42. Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is from the Lord, and it is marvelous in our eyes.'" This is Jesus speaking in advance of his rejection, death, and crucifixion. He says scriptures must be fulfilled. Jesus knew that his death was foretold by scripture, by the prophets. After his death and resurrection, he met certain disciples on a road. The disciples were sad and incredulous that this stranger knew nothing of the crucifixion and death of Jesus of Nazareth. Before revealing Jesus was Jesus, he spoke to them about the situation and their sadness. Luke 24:25. Then he said to them, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?" And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Believing that a human is a God is why Jesus was sent to the cross. Dear Muslim, please understand the suffering and the crucifixion is completely documented by the prophets that Islam tells you to respect. Also because of the snake that betrayed him. Yes, Judas was a snake inspired by Satan. But that also was not a surprise to Jesus or God. Remember, Jesus said, "But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." I think it is critical that you understand Judas was not the cause that made Jesus be crucified. He was a sincere but ignorant Jew, just like sincere but ignorant Muslims who reject Messiah, the Son of God. We say he's the Son of God because we are told in Romans 1:4 he was declared to be the Son of God with power, proven to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. None of Jesus' disciples said he is God. It is not an intellectually mature position to expect the disciples to say, quote, "You are God," unquote, as evidence or proof. But we can examine what the disciples and others did say about Jesus. Matthew 14:33, "Then they that were on the ship came and worshipped him, saying, Of a truth, you are the Son of God." Matthew 16:15, "He saith unto them, But whom say you? Whom do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto you, but my Father which is in heaven." Believing or recognizing Jesus is the Son of God is a revelation from God. Only in the book of John. I think I just showed you verses from Matthew which proclaim Jesus is the Son of God. Things Islam has taught you are false, brother. In fact, nothing you have learned from Islam is of value or completely true. Except this. There is one living God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who sent the prophets. Only the book of John, which was written 200 years after Jesus. Prophet Daniel revealed his vision of the Son of Man. The Son of Man is an eternal being with an eternal kingdom. Jesus called himself the Son of Man over and over. Jesus said, "You would die in your sins if you did not believe Jesus was the Son of Man." John 8:24. "That is why I told you that you would die in your sins. For unless you believe that I am He," and another scripture right around that, "He" is a reference to the Son of Man, "you will die in your sins." Jesus is God, my friend. The prophets have revealed this. Don't be foolish and slow of heart to believe the prophets, brother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.